Hello, and welcome to TV Coast to Coast, where we discuss what's tasty on television each week. I'm Vicki Hyman from the Star Ledger and NJ.com in New Jersey, with Mark Dawidziak of the Plain Dealer in Cleveland.com, and Dave Walker from NOLA.com and the Times-Picayune. Christy Turnquist from the Oregonian has the week off. Welcome, guys.
Hi. Hey there.
Later in the program, I'll be discussing Eaten Alive, Sunday night's grossly oversold Discovery Channel special, in which a New Jersey-raised naturalist was perhaps drooled on by an anaconda, but was definitely not eaten. Mark and David will talk about Tuesday night's series finale of Sons of Anarchy on FX, but first, David is going to be talking about the new HBO documentary regarding Susan Sontag, about the celebrated writer, critic, and cultural figure who died in 2004. Dave?
Yeah, filmmaker Nancy Cates hits the career highlights, which include the essay Notes on Camp and the book on photography, but really tightens her focus on Sontag's personal life, which was a kind of work of art in itself, and certainly worth celebrating for how Sontag navigated its complexities. Her work, magnetic personality, and eminently photogenic face made Sontag an enigmatic celebrity and an intellectual and feminist icon, demonstrating Sontag's work is the big job here. The act of writing and then the impact of what's been written are very difficult things to put on screen. Cates does so in mesmerizing fashion, using all kinds of artsy effects, and I really loved how she pulled it off. Patricia Clarkson is at times employed to voice to Sontag's words, though the author has plenty to say herself through archival interviews. I love the score as well. To her fans, Sontag was one of the most fascinating literary figures of her era. Regarding Susan Sontag, artfully explains why. I highly recommend it. That's Monday on HBO. Now, to make a complete pivot, a quick word about FX's scooter gang drama, Sons of Anarchy, which reaches its series finale Tuesday night. The finale was spoiled for some fans by a book of all things, and that's all that Google News can talk about today, which is too bad. A keepsake companion volume shipped too early and has details of the exit episode. Honestly, I think most fans are delighted only because they got one more profane Kurt Sutter social media rant about the premature pub date. Sutter, a veteran of The Shield and the show's creator, took full responsibility for what happened, as any of his characters would on the show. This has been one responsibility-taking show from the start. Its captains of illicit industry characters live by a rough code, and so many have died over its seven seasons. Few got to go gently, though most went with a kind of resignation that, to me, perfectly fit their code. That perfectly fits their view of the life they chose, even to its conclusion. I haven't been on board Sons of Anarchy for the whole ride. It's just too dark, too often, but many viewers have. It's FX's biggest audience, which says a lot when you consider it's also the network of Horror Story, The Americans, and Fargo. I've always admired Sons for its portrayals and craft, both of which were demonstrated in last week's episode-ending montage set to Ed Sheeran's Make It Rain. Really, really sweet TV making. Mark, what are your thoughts on this challenging show's last ride?
Well, you know, Dave, I know that you could particularly relate to this show. You were president of the Television Critics Association, so you know what it's like to lead an unruly gang that is unpredictable and can turn on you at any point. So you have a special insight to this show, which I don't have. But regardless of that, I also admire this show greatly and have since the first. You know, great dramas, great cable dramas have a great sense of themselves. It's sort of like what we say about great books, great writers. Great writing has a great sense of place. Great TV dramas not only have a great sense of themselves, they maintain it. And when shows go off the tracks, when we talk about great dramas going off the tracks, it's because they seem to lose this sense of what they are and what made them great to beginning. This show never lost sense of that. And we can't let it go gently into the dark night because it doesn't fit the theme of the show. It doesn't fit the characters. It doesn't fit the run. And let us now praise famous cable drama. For one thing, it's hard to stand out today in the cable drama field. There are so many great ones. And let's face it, Sons of Anarchy was never going to be Emmy bait. Any more than The Walking Dead is going to be. The Emmy voters are never going to vote for a show about a motorcycle gang called Sons of Anarchy. This show did everything right, however, and did everything right, including getting an audience, getting the highest audience in FX history. So Emmy voters didn't like it, but the viewers certainly did, and there was much to admire in this show. I'm with you, Dave. It wasn't always my type of storytelling, but every time I checked in with it, I was impressed not only with storytelling, the narrative power, but also their use of guest stars, something they don't get enough credit for. Over the run of this, they used guest stars, somebody unpredictable like Hal Holbrook showing up and doing just fantastic, luminous work. And, you know, this was a typical FX show in a lot of ways. When somebody died on this show, they tend to go in an icky way. In a way, never mind The Walking Dead. The people who got dispatched on Sons of Anarchy. And FX shows have always done this, by the way. Look at American Horror Story. Remember The Shield, how people would go on this. So it also served up these haunting, memorable moments which would stick with you for a while. And I think that's a good way to remember the show. It's going to stick with us for a while. Vicki?
Well, speaking of people who tend to go in icky ways, I watched Eaten Alive last night. And I think that if Discovery had only added a question mark, they could have avoided a lot of buyer's remorse this morning. The internet erupted in anger last night after an hour and 45 minutes of naturalist Paul Rosely hunting the Peruvian Amazon for Chumana, an anaconda so enormous it is supposedly capable of gulping down a grown man. He and his team gave up and used a backup anaconda, like a throwdown anaconda, for the much-hyped stunt. And after another 10 minutes or so of lead-up, this much smaller anaconda makes only a half-hearted attempt to eat Rosely, who is encased in a special suit to protect him. But the anaconda does squeeze him hard enough to make him fear for his arm, so he gives up. You know, it was so entertaining to read the tweets afterwards, and I think my favorite one was the person who said, "One time I got wrapped up in my comforter when I was napping, so I pretty much know how this dude is feeling." You know, it's hard to talk about the merits of the documentary, but I will for a little bit. The nature documentary, it's, you know, it was interesting. It was exciting at times. They did catch a couple of anacondas over the course of the hour and 45 minutes, but ended up throwing them back because it wasn't Chumana. But honestly, when you make promises like eat alive, people expect to see someone eaten alive. So it's hard to come away feeling anything but disappointed, which, you know, in turn, we think about it, is kind of disturbing. I spoke to Paul Rosely this morning, and he told me that A, he did try real hard to get eaten, and B, if literally all anybody wanted to see was a snake eat a guy, and they didn't want to look at
it. What? No, go ahead.
If literally all they wanted to see was a snake eat a guy and didn't want to think about the larger implications of this documentary, which is about saving the rainforest and its inhabitants of in, then, quote, maybe there's no point. Maybe there isn't. I don't know. Do you guys have any thoughts before we close?
Yeah, so basically, this is the Al Capone's vault.
Yes,
of nature,
yes. You know, they could have killed two duds with one stone had they sent an anaconda back in time to Al Capone's vault, who had killed Geraldo Rivera, and then there never would have been anaconda for Paul Rosely to find, and we never would have been subjected to either one of these.
Ah, I smell a supernatural tie-in here. Yes, let's get the Winchester boys on this.
We're still talking about Al Capone's vault, and that was a long time
it
ago.
It was great.
I remember it.
It was great.
Yes, it is.
Of course we are.
It is the millennial equivalent of Al Capone's vault.
That's right.
So next week, I think we will all be back to talk again about what's going on in TV. So in the meantime, enjoy your lead up to the holidays and all the holiday specials. And I will see you next week.